Dear learners and listeners, I'm Dr. Shweta, and today we'll be talking about understanding individual differences, the case of intelligence. So let us know that what we are going to understand from this very lesson. First of all, this lesson will make us understand the meaning of psychological assessment. We will also be knowing the basic features of psychological tests that are used in assessment. This will also help us to explain that what actually intelligence is. So, let us begin with today's topic. First of all, let us know that what is the nature of psychological assessment. How do we do psychological assessment? What actually psychological assessment is? So, we usually do the psychological assessment with the help of a psychological test. Now, what is a psychological test? A psychological test is a structured technique which is used to generate a carefully selected sample of behavior, which means that it is a planned technique in order to know about somebody's behavior. There are some important features that a psychological test has. It is necessary that the test should be reliable, valid, and standardized. Let us know about the three aspects of psychological test in detail. First of all, let us know what is reliability of the test. A test is reliable if it measures something consistently. For example, if you assess something, then the scores obtained on the separate occasion, say 6 months, should be same. If a scale tells two different values while assessing the same object on the two occasions, then it is called an unreliable test, which means that if your intelligence scores today are showing a different value and after 6 months they show a different value, then this means that the test is unreliable. The second is the validity of the test. The validity of the test is actually the degree to which the test measures what it intends to measure. That is, a valid test of personality gives a measure of person's personality and predicts behavior in situations where that aspect of personality is found important. In simple language, this means that when we assess a particular measure with the help of a test, then the items that are there in the test must be related to the content that we intend to measure. That is the example which is given here, that the test should measure what it intends to measure. If it is a personality test, then all items in the test must relate to the personality assessment. Then comes the standardization. We must know that how a test is standardized. Standardization involves establishing the procedure of administration of a test to all persons in the same way. Let us know this in more detail. In order to standardize a test, we must take the norms. Norms involve comparison of a score of a person with those of others in a defined social norm. So, this was the norms that are used to standardize a test. Let us now know that what is the concept of intelligence? How do we define intelligence? There are very few things which are so obvious and elusive as intelligence is. This means the difference in intellectual achievements are expressed in the form of your performance. For example, if we take the marks in school examination of 10th grade students, it will yield a distribution in which most people show moderate level of performance and very few are on the extremes, showing extremely high, which is excellent, or extremely low, which is very poor level of performance. The same is true about intelligence. If you are looking at the curve which is there in the slide, then you must understand that the bell-shaped area means that most of the people will be falling in that bell-shaped area. That is, most of the people's score would be falling in that bell-shaped area. But few will be extremely high on intelligence and few will be extremely low on intelligence. So, when we talk about intelligence, then we must know that how do we define intelligence and what are the various IQ scores that we take. So, for example, the table clearly indicates that what is the IQ ranges. For example, if somebody's score on an intelligence test is 140 and above, then we would say that the individual is near genius or is actually a genius. If the scores on the intelligence test, that is the IQ score, if it comes around 130 to 139, then this means that the person is very superior. And likewise, we have given the various ranges to different levels of intelligence. Now, most of the researchers relate intelligence to the following broad classes of abilities. First is, what is intelligence? So, somebody would define intelligence as adapting to new situations and changing according to the situations. Another person would define intelligence as learning from your past experiences. And intelligence can also be defined as your ability to think abstractly using symbols and concepts. Now, we also must understand that what are the viewpoints on intelligence. Now, we must also know that what are the major viewpoints on intelligence. How do people define intelligence in their own terms? So, first of all, we'll talk about the factorial viewpoint of intelligence. Let us understand what is this factorial viewpoint and who gave this factorial viewpoint. So, first is that intelligence is described as a general factor. Spearman was the propounder of this theory. According to Spearman, he proposed that we possess one general intelligence factor, and he named that general intelligence factor as G. And we have many other specific factors and we call them as S, which are specific to particular abilities. The G factor actually runs across all types of abilities. That is, the G factor actually is used in other specific abilities also, and it is expressed in the ability to understand the abstract relations. Then comes the multiple factors of intelligence, which is also a part of factorial intelligence, or how do we define intelligence in terms of factors. So, this multiple factor theory of intelligence was given by Thurston. Thurston proposed that intelligence actually consists of seven factors, and he named those factors as verbal comprehension, word fluency, number, space, associative memory, perceptual speed, induction, or which you call as a general reasoning ability. Multiple factors of intelligence. Thurston developed a test of perceptual speed and induction, or the general reasoning. He developed a test of primary mental abilities, which is known as PMA, to measure the different factors that we just described. Now, the another theory which comes under the same thing is the structure of intellect. The structure of intellect model was proposed by Guilford. Guilford proposed this model, which classifies intellectual traits along the main three dimensions, and those three dimensions are operations, contents, and products. That is, how do we define intelligence? We define intelligence on the basis of operations, contents, and products as per Guilford. Let us understand that what do we mean by operations, contents, and products in detail. So, when we talk about operations, this means that what a person does. That is operation, what a person does. Operation includes your cognition, that is how, what is your thought process, your memory, divergent production, or we call it creativity, convergent production, and the evaluation. So, as per Guilford, the operations are the cognition, memory, divergent production, convergent production, and evaluation. Then he described that the second comes the contents. What are the content? That is, this refers to the nature of material or information on which operations are performed. These includes visual, auditory, symbolic, for example, the letters, numbers, or semantic, which is the words, and behavioral and figural information about the person's behavior, attitude, needs, etc. Then comes the products, which refers to the form in which information is processed by a person. Products are classified into units, classes, relations, systems, transformations, and implications. To know more, I will just explain that how do you understand, how will you be able to understand the structure of intellect. For example, I give you a certain problem. Now, first of all, you need to do some operation on that problem. What is that operation? You might think about that problem. You might recollect from your memory about how you can solve it, or you might have a creative idea of solving it, or you might rely on the convergent production and evaluation. So, first of all, the thinking process which goes for the particular problem, that is operations. Then comes the content. You are doing that operation on a particular content. It may be a visual situation, it can be an auditory situation, it can be a number problem or anything else. And last come the products, that is when you do certain operation on some contents, then you come out with some products, and those are classified in terms of units, classes, relationship between different things, or transformations and implications. So this is how we understand the structure of intellect model. So it is clear that factorial viewpoint presents a view of intelligence in terms of trait organization. There is another viewpoint on intelligence also, like the next, which is related to cognitive science tradition, that is the information processing. Let us understand what is this concept. So, this defines intelligence as a process. As already said, that this viewpoint is related to cognitive science tradition. In particular, it is related to the information processing model. That is, how do you process the information that comes from the outer environment? It traces the processes of acquisition, representation, and use of information in undertaking the intellectual activities. So, another theory that defines intelligence as a process is the triarchic theory. Triarchic theory was given by Robert Sternberg, and he analyzed intelligence in the three aspects. Those three aspects was your componential intelligence, experiential, and the contextual. Let us understand this in detail. The componential aspect includes those processes which are employed by a person taking a test in responding to the items of standardized intelligence tests. Its constituents include metacomponents or higher order control process, performance component, acquisition component, and transfer component. The second aspect, which is known as the experiential one, refers to the way people's mental world and the outer or external world are related to each other. It adds creativity to the notion of intelligence. In reality, a person's intelligence shapes his or her experiences. Also, the experience which one has influences intelligence. Then the third aspect, which is the contextual aspect. So, it refers to the way individuals share their environments and adapt to them. That is contextual. How do you adapt to the context and try to get maximum from the available resources? It is also called as the practical intelligence. In this, another comes the theory of multiple intelligences, and it was given by Howard Gardner. Howard Gardner was of the viewpoint that individuals possess 8 types of intelligence, which is linguistic, logical or mathematical, spatial, musical, bodily, kinesthetic, interpersonal, and natural. Now, let us also understand that how do we define intelligence in the non-cognitive domains. In the previous domain, we emphasized on defining intelligence in terms of rational and cognitive domain. But in recent years, many other aspects have been explored. One such aspect is wisdom. What is wisdom? We all know that it comprises a unique blend of cognitive, interpersonal, social, and personality attributes. It is a knowledge that effectively integrates emotional and the cognitive components of an individual. Another related component is the practical wisdom, which is the practical achievement of personal goals, plans and intentions. And the practical wisdom is characterized by a flexible and applied concern for the practical contingencies, especially in the face of uncertainty. That is, how do you react when there is uncertainty? What is the practical wisdom? What is the demand of the situation? How do we react according to the demand of the situation? That is practical wisdom. Another is the social intelligence. It has also received attention by the researchers. What is social intelligence? It actually represents the effort of an individual to solve the problems of daily life and work towards the desired goals, because we all are social animals and we live in the social world. So we have to make use of our intelligence if we want to survive in this social world. Another very important component in the non-cognitive domain is emotional intelligence. Emotional intelligence is that how do you understand yours and others' feelings and emotions, to discriminate among them and to use this information to guide one's thinking and action. That is, how do you understand yourself as well as others in order to understand the phenomena which happens around us. So, these were some of the models that we talked about for intelligence. So, dear learners, this is all about today's program. But before I end up, we must know that what we did today, we actually could understand that what is psychological test, what are the various features of psychological testing, and we also talked about the different theories of intelligence, in which we talked about the factorial model of intelligence. We also understood that how do we define intelligence in the cognitive domain, that is intelligence as an information processing system, and at the end we talked about intelligence as the non-cognitive domain, that is we discussed how can we define intelligence in the non-cognitive domain, in which we talked about the wisdom, the practical wisdom, social intelligence and emotional intelligence. So, this was all about today's program. With this note, I end up for today's lesson. I hope you have understood well. Thank you.